patience with me, but we're going to get started with Oscar giving us a prelude, and I'm going to go put on a robe so that we can start celebrating this first Sunday after Christmas. Thanks be to God. Thank you. Appropriate song for today. Thank you, Stefan, for changing the slide to our welcoming portion and station here today here at St. James Presbyterian Church. You see, it's Communion Sunday, and we will be sharing our communion today. The elements have been blessed It is still the second Sunday, the first Sunday after Christmas, so our tree and poinsettias are still here. And we welcome you to St. James Presbyterian Church here on the corner of St. Nicholas Avenue and 141st Street in the village of Harlem in the city of New York. We have a few wonderful people who are with us here today. We're so grateful to all of you who are with us online as well. And I will be the one who will be letting you in, letting all of our participants in as we go. So please be patient with me. I want to ask your prayers for Brother Chris Bozel, who has come down with COVID. He got COVID as soon as he got his COVID shot and his COVID booster and his flu booster. And then he came down with COVID and got a really bad case, so we're giving him the day off. Also, we know that Brenda Spivey is at home as well with COVID, so we want to wish her well. But we're going to get started with our worship today, and we're going to thank God for all of those who are with us and all of those who will be joining us in person and online as well on this Communion Sunday. Hear now our Psalm of the Day, which is Psalm 148. Hear these words of this psalm, where the entire cosmos, earth, and human beings celebrate and praise the glory of God. Here's these words. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded and they were created. He established them forever and ever. He fixed their bounds, which cannot be passed. Praise the Lord from the earth, you sea monsters and all deeps, fire and hail, snow and frost, storm and windy and wind, fulfilling his command. The mountains and the hills, fruit trees and all cedars, wild animals and all cattle, creeping things and flying birds. Kings of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the earth, young men and women alike, old and young together. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His glory is above earth and heaven. He has raised up a horn for his people, praise for all his faithful, for the people of Israel who are close to him. Praise the Lord. Thanks be to God. I would like to introduce you to our ruling elder, Andrea Bradford, who joins us as our liturgist, who is remote with us, and we are extending our mission and our ministry, in this case, all the way down to Alabama. Ruling Elder Andrea Bradford.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning and Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
We're going to have a wonderful 2023, and it's the first day of the year. What a time to be together, to be able to commune together, and to receive Holy Communion together as well. And so,
thanks be to God. Let us start with our call to worship, having heard our Psalm of the Day, and let us start together thinking and understanding that through faith, God brings us through. Let us hear our call to worship, Ruling Elder Andrea Bradford.
Amen. Thank God for technology, but when it does not work, we can be in trouble. So we are back, and in worship. In the newness of this day, we profess and claim the timeless bond with God, faith.
And as a community of faith, we believe with all our hearts in the righteous victory of our struggle.
We celebrate this faith as Imani during Kwanzaa, calling forth an ancestral reminder of God, seeing us through to new beginnings.
We promise to celebrate the fullness of faith with praise, with song, and with prayer. For it is in our faithfulness that our worship takes on meaning and purpose. So let's just praise the Lord. Amen and amen. Our opening song, our opening hymn, can be found at number, it's called, when I get to it.
Oh, hang on the power.
All hail the power of Jesus' name. And it's hymn number
Amen, amen. All hail the power of Jesus' name. I always say, go back and look at the words to those hymns. They are so beautiful and so beautifully and thoughtfully written. So I offer that today as well. Our prayers, our hymns, they all come together to form the message for this first Sunday in 2023. And so now we go into our time of prayer, beginning with our prayer of adoration in the same spirit of hailing the power of Jesus' name, our prayer of adoration. There's power in glory in the name of Jesus. Every time his mother Mary cuddled him and called his name, she let the world know, the Lord is my salvation. When we call on the name of Jesus, we invoke the saving power and presence of God's great glory. Yet with all the majesty and holiness in the name of Jesus, it is still the sweetest name we know.
Amen, amen. And those of you who know this old song, if you remember the words to it, just sing out. Otherwise, just sit back and enjoy the rock and roll of God. Jesus, oh, what a wonderful child.
You said, Jesus, Jesus. Thank you.
Yes, amen and amen indeed. We praise God and we praise the birth of Jesus, the wonderful child, Jesus. We know what's going to happen, but we're now just praising the birth and the start of the life of Jesus. And we continue on our journey. We continue on our path. We know that sometimes we don't always stay on that path, but we try to stay as close as we can, and we ask for the guidance of God in that journey. We have this time to say that we're sorry when we do not stay on that path. The sins we bring in our confessions are the words of reparation to God for the sinfulness of our humanity. As we lift our voices together in our hearts, we cry, "Oh Lord, hear our prayer." And so we say this prayer of confession now together.
To you, O God, we lift this prayer for the cleansing of our hearts and spirits. We lift up for praise and honor the humble beginnings of Christ. He was born to a young mother, unwed at the time she became pregnant. His family turned away from hospitality because the rich had taken all the rooms. The authorities had come searching to kill him for the promise he gave to people and stopped, frisked, and killed so many others to satisfy their quota. This holy family were immigrants to a foreign land, escaping persecution. Our confession lies in how we answer this question today. How do we treat the sacred stories of refugees and immigrants today? Let that resonate in your heart as we have a moment of silent confession. I was telling Oscar the story behind this song earlier today. In the early 1930s, there was a revival that was happening in the hills, in the Appalachian Trail, in the hills of North Carolina. These very, very poor people were trying to figure out how they were going to find faith and hope, and they were forced out by the authorities from their worship space. And there was a little 9-year-old girl in a tattered dress, dirt on her face. And as they were being forced away, she kept singing this melody. And she kept saying just these few words. And the person who was there, John Jacob Niles, heard her and was so struck by her, haunted by her really, that over the next few years, he put together this song, thinking about her and thinking about Christ. Hear these words.
I wonder, as I wander out on this
Jesus, the Savior, did come for to die for poor, ordinary people like you and like I.
I wonder as I wander. I wonder as I wander. And Jesus says, yes, I wonder as I wander. And God says, I know you are wandering. And I know you wonder, and I'm there. I'm there to forgive you. You have my assurance that you are forgiven. We have the forgiveness of God with Christ's grace and mercy as our gifts of life. We are called simply to use these gifts to be better, do better. For the chance to make a difference, we say thank you and amen.
Next song is Completely Yes. Can you say, with this assurance of pardon, that you will do your best to be better and to do better? If so, say, yes, Lord, from the bottom of my heart to the depths of my soul. Yes, Lord, yes, completely yes. And then I love you from the bottom of my heart to the depths of my soul. I love you, my soul says yes.
From the bottom.
Because they will inspire you throughout the week as well to remember our text and our scripture. Welcome again to St. James Presbyterian Church. It is so good to be here with you in a warm sanctuary today.
Amen.
We are grateful to God that we have figured out our technology for one thing or the other. When one piece of technology starts to work, we get crazy with our other technology. So forgive me for some of our technological mishaps moving forward, but that's how we do things here. So we want to welcome you to St. James Presbyterian Church, and we want to thank you for being here with us on this first day of New Year, the New Year, January 1st, 2023. And we welcome you to this new year of God's new promises, God's new mercies, and God's new graces. I don't know about you, but I don't worry about the ball dropping, and I don't worry about making resolutions. What I worry about is looking for and being aware of all the good and beautiful things that God is going to do for us in the coming year. So let us be vigilant, and let us keep our eyes on the prize and keep our eyes open for what God is going to do. Amen and amen. I hope you all had a wonderful week of Kwanzaa as well, to celebrate the principles of Kwanzaa as founded by Dr. Karenga in the late 1960s. An opportunity for African Americans to have a tradition that was rooted in our African traditions as we as the people of the African diaspora, to share these wonderful, wonderful technologies and wonderful ideas of faith and kujichakalia and ways of coming together. And if you notice today is the day of Imani. It's the last day of Kwanzaa. And Imani means faith. And actually, in our call to worship, I sort of lift it up from what we say for Kwanzaa when we read the principles that Imani is that we as a community of faith, we believe with all of our hearts in the righteous victory of our struggle, in our community, in our collectiveness, in our collective ability to bring ourselves up and lift ourselves up economically. And I want to tell you one of my favorite things that is an evidence of faith that the world is having a hard time dealing with right now, and it's on TikTok. On TikTok, there is a trend that is trending for African-American women to follow one another, trend one another, and to support one another. And I gotta tell you, the world is upset that Black women are doing something good for themselves.
Amen.
And it is a beautiful thing. It is a beautiful thing to see these women supporting one another and lifting one another up and following one another and listening to one another and lifting up their struggles and their pains, just as a collective online group of Black women supporting Black women. And I want to lift that up because they have found a faith in their community that no one can take away from them. And I'm so proud of that and so happy of that event. So Imani, everyone, and it is represented in that collective responsibility as a community of faith that we can believe in the righteous victory of our struggle. And faith is in our journey today with our scriptures and with Jesus. This has been a tough week for me with this particular scripture. This is a scripture that is hard to hear in our gospel lesson. It's hard when we really think about what it's called for. It's hard when we look at the front of our bulletin cover and imagine Mary, Joseph, and Jesus traveling through the desert, through the literal desert of northern Africa to go from Bethlehem to Egypt. It's been a painful reminiscence of being and living in this text a week. But what I came up with is the idea that they had this faith in God, that God would bring them through. How powerful that is, a message for us, that here these two immigrants and their child who were crossing a border, thank God they let them in the border of Egypt at that time, but with nothing, nothing more than the little bit of gold that they would have to live on, frankincense and myrrh, and a skill and a trade. And even though Joseph was a carpenter, we know a carpenter works with wood. In Egypt, they did a lot of work with stone. So we wonder how he made a living. Just like so many of the immigrants that come to the United States here today, are what? Doctors, lawyers, scientists, and you will find them being Uber drivers and delivery persons on bikes because they cannot find jobs here in the United States. So how do we treat our immigrants? How does our government treat our immigrants? And how would they have treated Jesus? We should think. Anyway, enough of that. I just wanted to bring that to you and bring that to mind. I won't be preaching a lot on that, so I just wanted to lift that up for a little bit. I want to say also in this beginning of the new year that we do want to remind everyone from our finance team that we are going to be collecting our apportionment this year. Every person who is a member of St. James, and this is for all of you who are online, and those of you who are here in our sanctuary as well, if you have stood up here and said yes to being a member of St. James, we know we have a lot of people at St. James who haven't actually officially joined, so I don't want to pressure you as well, but this is for all of the members, because on our rolls for the National Church, we have a certain amount of members, and every one of those members, we are offering an apportionment, which means that we help pay for the presbytery, we help pay for the synod, and we help pay for the national church and its missions. And we do that at $60 a person here at St. James. Just a nice rounded figure of $60 to also pay back some past apportionment that were done under other sessions and other leadership here at St. James that we're sort of fixing up and taking care of. So thanks be to God. Be prayerful about that, because if there's an opportunity where you are blessed and you find yourself with $20 here, $20 here, and $20 there, and it ends up being $60, and you know we have sick and shut-in people and folks that aren't able to pay, just send in another donation anonymously or so, or just say, I just want to pay for somebody else's apportionment. And that will be a blessing in your heart to God's ministry here at St. James. Amen. And amen. I also want to, you can start sharing the screen now. I forgot that I have a slide now. I just wanted to remind you all as well that if you wanted to be in touch with us, you can do so via our email, which is stjames409@verizon.net. You can be in touch with me at my pastor's email, pastor141@verizon.net. All of this is on your bulletin, on the slide. And we're also going to be doing some updating of our website, stjamesharlemnyc.org. I'm carving out time in this month to sort of bring us up to date a little bit for 2023, so that we'll be able to share what we're doing, what's going on, and we are grateful for that as well. You'll also, if you move to the next slide, you'll be able to see that we will be having Bible study next week. Bible study tomorrow night, January the 2nd. You'll see the scriptures that are there. We're sticking with Isaiah, Psalm 29. We're moving to Acts 10, and we're going to be staying within the Gospel of Matthew, because we're going to be celebrating the baptism of Jesus next week. We're moving through the life of Jesus in this liturgical year A. So we want to thank you and ask that if you would like to join us, to please do so. You can call in, as you see on screen, at 646-931-3860, and you will need to add in the meeting ID number 351-839-677. If you have any issue with that, just email me at pastor141@verizon.net. Can we get a hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
When we say hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. The other day, actually on Friday, I shook hands with our contractor, Mr. Singh, and we said, thank you, God, because St. James Presbyterian Church, during COVID and during a pandemic, has paid off a $73,000 debt to fix the parapet. Nothing but God.
Amen.
So I thank all of you who have given. And all of you were given specifically for the parapet wall. That was such a great feat that we did. We'll find other new things that we'll do for capital improvements, but that emergency just shows us what we can do when we put our hearts and minds and spirits to it and allow the Holy Ghost to work with us and live within us. So we are grateful, 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 and God has blessed us, and God is blessing us. He was very excited to hear about the fact that we have an architectural assessment that was done here for $42,000. That was money that was granted to us from different organizations, and that architectural assessment should be with us soon. And with that architectural assessment, we'll be able to put in for more grants to do more work within the building. I do understand that when we ask for money all the time, many people may get frustrated and say, why are we asking for money? Why are we asking for money? We're giving our offering. You know, we should be able to do this. Well, I wanted to let you know that I'm doing my part, and I'm going out here in the world, and I am trying to write these grants, and I'm trying to be in conversation with people about getting money to bring in here for our ministry, for what we do, because I believe in this purpose, and I believe in this history. And I know that we are all burdened economically, but I also know that when we give, that God gives to us, and that we have been so blessed.
Yeah.
Think about it, St. James.
Yeah.
Put a $50,000 roof on the gym,
yeah.
$73,000 for the parapet wall,
yeah.
And God has blessed us also with this $42,000, plus other monies that are coming in from many different sources. From people who are visiting with us online, around the world, we thank you. And those of you who are right here in New York City and in our congregation, God is good. And all the time. And just to let you know, one last announcement, I'm just going to say this right now. February is going to be an important month for us. On the third Sunday of February, we're going to celebrate officially the 200th anniversary of Shiloh Presbyterian Church. Actually, it's the 200th anniversary of African-American Presbyterianism in the city of New York that started with our mother church, that started with our history. There's no longer, I'm erasing the separation that is a faulty separation that was done by the privileged presbytery in the late 1800s to close Shiloh and start up St. James. That history is one and the same. So we are claiming that, and we are holding on to that. We're going to... I'll be making some further announcements about that in the future. So we're going to be using February, our Black History Month, to celebrate that. We're also going to be celebrating the wonderful, wonderful things that our young people have been doing. We have got some great things to share with you. Shelby's been doing some incredible things. She's got this incredible award to share from the Girl Scouts that we'll talk about when the time comes. We're also going to celebrate her with that. We're going to celebrate our young people who are out there doing incredible things. Lamia's singing so beautifully in her classical music from Harlem School of the Arts. We have some of our children who are doing incredible things. I forgot to send you the link, Andre. I can't wait for you to hear it. Such beautiful things. So we are on the move doing things.
Yeah.
And it's so strange because you would never think it when you walk into a building and say, well, it looks sort of quiet in there, but things are happening. Oh, and the Winter League of Punk is doing another team, and there will be a St. James team again. So we're in the community as well. Those are the announcements. Let us just move forward with our worship. I'm just so excited about so many things, and sometimes I need to boost myself up and be happy about all the things that we're doing, because when you're in the middle of doing stuff, you forget how incredible God is being. So when we speak on it and testify, this is my testimony for us, that God is doing a good thing. Hear now our saying for the day. Our saying for the day is also about faith. When you're wondering how you are going to climb that mountain, when you are wondering, as the song says, his eyes on the sparrow, though by the path he leadeth, but one step I see, his eyes on the sparrow, and I know he watches over me. This small quote speaks to that as well. One may walk over the highest mountain, one step at a time. And that is a saying from the beloved Barbara Walters, which we honor her in her passing at 93, as well as Pele, our Afro-Brazilian soccer player who changed the world of soccer. And we are so grateful for his life and legacy as well. So thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. Ruling Elder Andrea Bradford.
Yes, yes. This has been an interesting week, but we also are moving forward on January 1st.
Yes.
And so we appreciate all of these announcements and keeping us informed of what's going on. And we also are so proud of the retiring of our debt for the parapet wall. I just have to say that it has been quite a journey of getting the money together, but we give praise and honor to God and to everyone who has had anything to do with any of that, that we made it. Pastor, there is a sound in the sanctuary, it seems, that is very loud on what we're hearing. Ah, that's better already. And so let's go now to our peace that we can share with one another. The angels came to Joseph with the peace of Christ in the horror of persecution. May this assurance of peace be with you all.
And also with you.
Who, as soon as he got his flu shot and booster for COVID, he got COVID. And he got it bad.
Oh my goodness.
And we want to give a special shout out and thank you for the reformation of our men's group, the Presbyterian Men of St. James, because they've been working together offline and sort of just meeting and doing whatever they need to do. But I do know that it's worth the community that is built. You understand this in Presbyterian women, Rita. It's that the idea that Chris Bozell, who has COVID, has a neighbor up the street that's a member of the church, Anthony Terrell, that has been checking on him every day, visiting with him every day, and taking him food every day.
Wow.
Anthony's not here because he doesn't want to make sure that he doesn't want to infect anybody else. And he says he's fine, but he wants to make sure. But I just think that is the purpose of community.
Yes, right.
That's what we do at church. That is the life of the church. And we are just so grateful that even in our times of struggle, that we're able to take care of one another and pray for one another. As we are praying for Deacon Brenda Spivey, who also is down with COVID.
Mm-hmm.
You know, every time we seem to be pulling out of this, a new strain comes and does something with us. But we want to give thanks for her and for her being here online with us today and knowing that God is going to take care of us and do new things. There are many people to pray for, many of us who have prayers in our hearts. When it comes time for our prayer, I'm going to take a few moments of silence before our prayer for the prayers for the people. And I want you to think about every single person who is on your heart for prayer. Anthony, our sexton, and I this week have been talking with a young lady, or talking about a young lady who we're not sure what's going on with her. She's lost on all social media. She's nowhere to be found. But she's contacting people, sort of, but we still don't know what's going on with her. So we're going to keep her in our prayers as well as the gentleman who we often see as a community fixture, who helps drive with Ventas, the maroon van that you see. He drives and helps pick up the body so that they can be prepared for funerals. And he died of a heart attack suddenly this week.
Oh my God.
And so when you see somebody around the neighborhood regularly, Anthony and I were just out there talking with him the other day, we want to lift up the fact that there is mourning going on and that we will offer our prayers. So that's why we ask for you to think about all of the people. Even if you go through service, and even if you don't listen to my sermon, and you're writing down people and writing down situations, I don't mind, because our prayer is what's needed in this world. Amen?
Amen.
And amen. Ruling Elder Andrea Bradford, I would like to ask if you would help move us through, because we're going to share the screen. I'm going to read the prayer of illumination, ask us to do that together, and then I'm going to ask you to read the scriptures, Ruling Elder Andrea Bradford, because they are, as I said earlier, for me personally, they are difficult scriptures. So I need to say this prayer and ask y'all to pray with me as we do this in the prayer of illumination that you'll see in your bulletin and on the screen, and then Ruling Elder Andre Bradford will read for us our scripture. In the words of our scripture, may we hear the revelation and proclamation of Christ as the children of God given to Christ. Let us say that out loud together again. In the words of our scripture, may we hear the revelation and proclamation of Christ as the children of God given to Christ. Ruling Elder Andrea Bradford.
Yes, and that's a beautiful prayer to lead us in to our readings this morning. We have three readings, as we typically do. The first is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 63, verses 7 through 9. Isaiah 63, 7 through 9. I will recount the gracious deeds of the Lord, the praiseworthy acts of the Lord, because of all that the Lord has done for us, and the great favor to the house of Israel, that he has shown them according to his mercy, according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he said, surely they are my people, children who will not deal falsely. And he became their savior in all their distress. It was no messenger or angel, but his presence that saved them. In his love and in his pity, he redeemed them. He lifted them up and carried them all the days of old. Yeah. And from Hebrews, in the New Testament, Hebrews, the second chapter, verses 10 through 18, Hebrews 2, 10 through 18. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, here am I and the children whom God has given me. Since, therefore, the children share flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared the same things, so that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by the fear of death. Yeah. For it is clear that he did not come to help angels, but the descendants of Abraham. Therefore, he had to become like his brothers and sisters in every respect, so that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God, to make a sacrifice of atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself was tested by what he suffered, he is able to help those who are being tested. That is from Hebrews. And now our gospel reading from the book of Matthew, the second chapter, verses 13 through 23. Matthew, the second chapter, verses 13 through 23. Now, after they had left, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, get up, take the child and his mother, and flee to Egypt. and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him. Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother by night, and went to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I have called my son." When Herod saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, he was infuriated, and he sent and killed all the children in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had learned from the wise men. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. A voice was heard in Ramah, wailing and loud lamentation. Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be consoled because they are no more. When Herod died, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel. For those who were seeking the child's life are dead." Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel. And when he heard that Archelaus was ruling over Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. And after being warned in a dream, he went away to the district of Galilee. There he made his home in a town called Nazareth, so that what had been spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled. He will be called a Nazarene. This is the word of God for the people of God.
If we move to the next slide, you'll see that we want to have a little conversation with our young people before we move into our worship, into our sermon, which is a new beginning for faith. And young people, I just want you to hear this and hear this good news. Jesus, born like you and me. I want you to understand how incredibly joyful and powerful it is that Jesus born just like you and me. Why is that so important? When we pray, we are often praying to God about things that are happening in our lives, things that we would like, or praying for other people who are sick and who are hurt, and other people whose family members are going through some sort of trouble or trauma. In Hebrews, it says that we can pray to Jesus because he himself was tested by what he suffered. He is able to help those who are being tested. Now, there is nothing like trying to go to somebody and tell them your problems and they have no clue what you're talking about. How are you going to have trouble with a test and say to the smartest person in the class who always gets A's, "I don't understand this"? I used to always hate when they would say, "You don't get that? It's really easy." I'm like, "But it's not easy to me." Right? And that sometimes it can feel like that, that we're praying to this almighty God who does and knows everything and creates everything. How can God understand our little problems? God can understand our little problems because Jesus understands our little problems. That's why he came to be a human being in flesh, just like us. To suffer like us. His mom told him to go to bed when he didn't want to go to bed. His father Joseph was searching for him, we'll find out later in some other scriptures, in the city of Jerusalem. He's saying, was ready to wring his neck and say, where were you? We thought you were lost. We were looking for you. He's like, didn't you understand that I'd be in my Father's house? Nobody understood, but Jesus wanted to be a human being so that our prayers, our endless prayers, Jesus can understand, because Jesus was born with a being, a human being living on this earth, just like us. So, that means that when we pray, we can have the faith that Jesus will understand. And that is a big, big part of faith, which is a whole school of things that people talk about, a whole subject. But that's one of the most important things. Why do we pray? Because Jesus knows what we're going through, because he went through, he saw other people going through as he walked on this earth. So today we just are grateful that Jesus, born like you and me. By the way, that is grammatically correct, because Jesus is the subject and we are the object. So when you are studying that in school and say, is it Jesus and me or Jesus and I? You can say, like you and me, not like I and you, because Jesus is the subject and we are the object of Jesus' love. And that is a grammatical way of understanding where I am being taught. I hear the teachers in the congregation, they can agree. Thanks be to God. Most gracious God, we spend our time and our lives, especially as we're growing up, and nobody understands us. We love our parents, but we still can't see how they understand what we're going through. Yeah, sometimes the pastor seems like he might know, but he don't even know what we're going through. Nobody seems to know. But we are grateful today, O God, that we have heard in our scripture that Jesus, he himself was tested by what he suffered, and he is able to help those who are being tested. So when nobody else knows, Jesus knows, and we are so grateful that we have a friend in Jesus, and that we can have faith that he understands, and if he understands, he can help us. Jesus be Amen.
Oh, for a minute there, I felt like I was back in grade school.
Wow. Oh, good. This is cool. I'm glad about that. I was listening to the words of this song that Oscar came this week, and I thought about the top sharing the screen. Thought about the bulletin cover that I finally chose. Mary, Joseph, and Jesus crossing the desert. Literally crossing the desert to go to Egypt because they were being persecuted and they were afraid for the life of their child. And I never really listened to this song that in mind before, but hopefully today you will hear what I mean. I pray you'll be our eyes and watch us where we go. And help us to be wise. Times when we don't know, let this be our prayer. When we lose our way, find your light and hold it in our hearts. Stars go out each night, remind us of where you are. Let this be New Beginnings in Faith. And no, I didn't write that title because it's New Year's Day. It just happened to fit. But New Beginnings in Faith. As I said to you earlier, this particular text is a very hard text to think about it actually happening. Jesus, Mary, Joseph, having been visited by the wise men who get an inkling that something's wrong with Herod and say, we're not going to go back and tell him where we found the Savior, as he was asked, as they were asked to do, those wise ones. But then all of a sudden to get another visit from the angel. Mary and Joseph have done a lot of hard work. Mary, first of all, is told by an angel, you're going to get pregnant and you're going to have a baby. And no, Joseph is not going to be the father. And you're going to have to deal with what that means to be a teenage girl who's engaged to somebody but not pregnant by him. So you're going to have to deal with that stigma. And then for Joseph to sit and wrestle and say, well, I don't know what I should do. It is my right to have her stoned, as it says in the book of Leviticus, because she cheated on me. But what do I do? Maybe I just push her away quietly, and then for an angel to come to him and say, Joseph, this is God's child. They believed the angels. Against all society, Joseph being laughed at by every man in his community. Yeah, right, an angel. Yeah, right. He's going to claim this child. Mary. People talking about her, you know she should have been stoned. You know that she shouldn't have any kind of grace. And yet, they do. And then comes this order, this decree, that you have to pick up from where you are, and that you have to travel while you are 8, 9 months pregnant, a teenager on a donkey, to Bethlehem. I don't know if any of you have ever ridden on a burro or ridden on a donkey. It is not as gliding as it seems as you're riding on a horse. It's difficult and it's bumpy. 9 months pregnant. Then to get to the town and find out that everybody else who's had to go there for the census, they've already taken all the hotel rooms. They've had the money. They got there earlier. They came in horses. Many of them maybe came in chariots, who knows? Maybe they were able to leave their businesses and walk there earlier. They didn't have all this other social mess going on about pregnancy and marriage and all that, but they still had to show up, and they made their way there only to have to be in a stable. Can you imagine being a 14, 15, 16-year-old girl, pregnant, in pain, in a stable, about to give birth to a child? We create these beautiful paintings and beautiful pictures of Mary swaddling baby Jesus in a cloth, but think about that moment when that water broke. Joseph has never been a father before. He doesn't know what to do. This is women's work. Men aren't in the room in the first century when women give birth to children. Joseph doesn't know what he's doing. And yet, here it's coming. This child is coming. The fear, the trauma, and childbirth is one of the number one causes of women's death in the first century. Giving life is the closest that women are to death. Take that in for a 14-year-old girl. And then you have all this wonderful stuff happen, and you're like, okay, maybe it makes sense now. God has brought these wise persons, the shepherds are coming, the angels are out there. I see that star up there, but then the angel comes and says, you gotta leave. It's relatively recently that pregnant women only who deliver only stay in the hospital for a couple of days. Mary had to get up and go. She had to get up and go. Back on that donkey. Back with that baby. And the trauma of taking the trip. If you remember Moses being sanctioned and having to go out into the desert? And then having to cross the desert again? Mary and Joseph are going across the desert from Bethlehem into Africa on a donkey and walking with a baby. So, we have these people of color who are poor, who are homeless, who are immigrants and migrants fleeing persecution from their government. And yet, they go. And yet they say yes. And yet they don't worry about the fact that this could be the end of us. They set out with this, saying, okay, this is our new beginning of our family. In faith. Our struggle has led us to this point that we know that with everything that we've gone through, that God has brought us through so far. So God is not going to leave us now. It's a new beginning, but they are moving forward in faith. Every struggle, every pain, every heartache that we have, like Mary and Joseph, is an opportunity for us to say, where is God leading me in my new beginning with faith? Yeah, let's bring 2022 into it. Think about these past few years and how horrible it's been. There's been a lot of mess that's gone on in the world, but here we are, still waking up in 2023 with a new beginning. Do you have the faith to keep moving on? Do you have the faith to keep walking and to keep trudging through this desert that seems to be our reality until you get to the city where God is calling you to rest, so that you can do what God needs to be done till everything gets settled again? You see, Joseph and Mary, they did go back, and they resettled in Nazareth. Their faith kept them well. It's only 10 verses of scripture, but these were several years. We're talking about 5 to 6 years that they spent in Egypt, in a foreign land, making a way out of no way. Why? Because God had done it for their people in Egypt. God had done it for their people in Babylon. God had done it so many times before, and they knew that the angel spoke to us that God is covering us. And our new beginning in faith, the lesson we have to figure out if we can believe and learn, do you believe that no matter what your struggle, that God has a new covering for you, that God is covering you to bring you out and to bring you through? This is what we are to learn about here today, I believe, in this particular instance, that God will make a way somehow. We struggle and we moan and we complain and we think that there's no way out. And then when we look back over our lives, we ask the question, how did I get over? My soul looks back and wonder how I got over. Can you imagine Mary, Joseph, and Jesus in Egypt finally saying, how did we get through that desert? Nothing but God's covering will do that. Will bring you through your desert into a new city. Even if it's just in a place for you to breathe for a little while, you will get what is due to you. Because God's promises are not lies. God's promises are not lies. Where, when? I don't know. I don't know, but I do know that if we can walk in faith, that as we go along the way, we can see these little flowers, these little germinations of things that are meant to give us joy and passion and peace and joy and love and understanding that we are covered by God. One of my favorite poems is Nikki Giovanni's Nikki Rosa. And Nikki Giovanni writes this poem and says, I grew up poor. I grew up poor, and we used to have parties and pour things into the bathtub so that people would be able to help us pay our rent. Mama and Daddy fought, but they loved one another. We didn't get much for Christmas, but we had each other. And I don't ever, in her poem, she says, want a white man to write my biography because I'll only talk about the pain and the suffering, but they won't talk about the love that we had. That's Nikki Rosa by Nikki Giovanni, one of my favorite poems. And it speaks to the idea of how do we go through the struggle and find new beginnings in our faith. We have to see how God is blessing us even in the midst of our struggle. I gave you that whole background of Mary and Joseph and their trauma and their social trauma and them being social pariahs and being having to give birth in a manger. But look at what happened. What do you think would have happened if we didn't know that Mary and Joseph were visited by these three people in a caravan that gave them gold? Enough gold to live for 5 to 6 years in a land called Egypt. God made a way. God made a way through the desert. God made a way for them. And God made a way for them to get back and still be safe. They settled outside of a town called Sepphoris. It was a trade town, a very rich Jewish town. They were about 3 to 6 miles outside of the city, in the suburbs, where it would be good to be a carpenter. Because if they would have gone back into Judea proper, the son of Herod is still in charge. The same line of Herod that will try Jesus in his last days. The same family, the same dynasty. They're all named Herod after their father. So Joseph is wise, and God has made a place for them, and God makes places for us. God makes spaces for us. They may not be the spaces that we think that we're supposed to be in, but when God puts you there, look around and see the blessings that God is giving you so that your faith will keep you walking the next step. That's the hard part of this journey, and that's why we are able to look at this scripture today and say, you know, God is showing us that God will carry us through our struggle. And as I said to the young people, if Jesus knows our struggle because he went through it. A child taken away from your own community, a culture, a religion, a people, to live in a land of foreign gods in your formative years. If you remember, these early years of Jesus are the formative years. So this is where he gets to understand what struggle and pain really is and why we need to be liberators and liberated through our faith. The people that are in our text today in Hebrews need to have a Savior that knows them, needs to know that there is a Savior who has been through what we've been through, and that the new beginnings come to us with long-term, deep-rooted faith. The hardest part about new beginnings in faith is to wait and see where God is bringing us. We don't have a problem thinking about that for the new year. We have anticipation about what can happen. We have joy about what we might be able to accomplish. We have these promises that we make that we're going to try and do something better. And yet when God asks us, when God asks us to hold on just a little while longer, where is our excitement? Where is our anticipation? This new beginning calls for faith. Whenever it looks like things are not going to work out, whenever it looks like just on the cover of that bulletin that you're stuck in the desert, holding your baby on the leg of a sphinx. Joseph lays out in the desert, watching while you sleep, the scorpions and adders. Knowing that God has got you under a hedge of protection is the faith that keeps us moving forward. We all struggle. We all struggle. Every single one of us struggles. Some people hide it better than others. I'm going to say that pure and simple. Some people hide it better than others. The richest people in the world have a network of people to hide their struggles, and their money can't bring them through. The poorest of people, our struggles seem to be out there in the forefront for everyone to see. But what they don't see is our ability to pull through and move through it. That's what watch night was about. That's what they did 100 some odd years ago last night. They believed in the promise of God and the promise of their ancestors that they would be free. And they waited for the stroke of midnight to say the Emancipation Proclamation is real. They found a new beginning in the faith of their ancestors and in their own faith. Our lives, day by day, are so filled with minuscule stuff that keeps our eyes focused and looking down that we cannot see the bigger picture of what is actually going on around us. It's time for us to lift up our heads. It's time for us to see what is around us, to see the blessings that are with us, to see how important we really are in this world, to see how much it matters that we are here, and to claim that importance, to claim that beauty that God sees in us, to claim that we are somebody because we are God's. And God is not about to let us just go by the wayside and be destroyed, that God is holding us through. Even though our world may seem like it's on fire, we are not on fire because we have the living water that is pouring over us, the living water of the Holy Spirit, the living water of Jesus Christ, the living water of God is around us and surrounding us while the world is on fire. So let us just bathe in that water while the world is on fire and say, you cannot touch me. I know that I am a child of God. Jesus said that you are my brothers and my sisters. You are mine. You are my family. You are not belonging to this world. You do not belong to those who are trying to tear you down and rip you apart. Where is your faith? If you can find your faith, I'll show you a new beginning. So work on your faith. That's all we got to do. Work on your faith. Work on our faith. And we will see these new beginnings and opportunities. Sometimes we have so many new beginnings, we don't know which one to choose. And trust me, that is how God works. When we lift up our heads and look on the horizon, those blessings come at you left and right. I just pray that we will be able to have an understanding that a new beginning in faith is a holy start. A new beginning may be a new direction. A new beginning may mean you have to stop moving and just sit. Think about how God is calling you. Have a new beginning in faith while you're in your struggle. Because then you will truly see that the Lord will make a way somehow. Most gracious and loving God, we are bereft by doing old things and seeing the same results. Yes, some say that is insanity, but it's also the treadmill that we find ourselves on, the treadmill that does not run on faith. It runs on fear. It runs on anger. It runs on feeling less than. We ask, oh God, that you would let our new beginnings run on faith, and that we will keep our heads up high so that we can see the opportunities that lay before us. So that when we are told that somebody is coming after us to take away our child, that we will say, oh yes, but we have a cache of gold that will tide us through. We can buy food. We will find shelter. God will make a way out of no way. Help us to live that truth, oh God, your truth, not our truth and not the world's truth, but your truth, oh God, that trouble don't last always, and that we will get to Egypt where we can rest for a while, and we will be able to come back to the place that is appointed for us, as Jesus and his family came back to Nazareth, so that we can watch and read and feel the power of the life of this little baby boy named Jesus Christ as he grows into a man from his humble new beginnings into a faithful Messiah to bring us salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us sing our hymn number 38 in your hymnal, "It Came Upon a Midnight Clear." Invites us into our prayers with the people. It says to us, "And ye beneath life's crushing load, whose forms are bending low, who toil along the climbing way with painful steps and slow, look now, for glad and golden hours come swiftly on the ring, on the wing." So in prayer we are asked to rest beside the weary road, and to hear the angels sing. Because there's another thing that this hymn did. It talked about the angels' wings unfurling. And just remember that they float above the earth. And when we rest and lift up our prayers, the wind underneath their wings carries our prayers to God. So I don't know if you've gotten your list together yet. Who you want to pray for? What situations you feel you need to have prayed for? Maybe you just feel like you're in a rut. You pay your bills, but you just pay them. You have to do without in order to make something else happen. Maybe the blessing that was given to you has so much responsibility to it that you're not sure if you can handle it. Maybe you're going through a battery of tests with your doctors and they don't quite know what's going on, but you know there's something different about your body and you're scared. Maybe you're just tired. Recognizing that with each day brings a new year, yes, but it also brings another year where our body tells us you're getting older. And maybe, just maybe, you've lost someone and they're on your mind right now. Maybe there's someone who is going through a medical condition who is not being taken care of properly and you don't know what to do. You've done all you can and you feel helpless. The only thing you can do is pray. Whatever it is, this is the moment to bring it to God. We are taught that when we pray, we lift up and mention God's holy presence and name, and we praise God so that we can recognize the power of God. And then we can ask for what it is that we believe that we need. And then we can tell God that we are grateful and we know that you hear our prayers. And then we lift it up. Say amen, may it be so. And leave it at the throne of God's mercy. So today we will say, most holy, gracious, powerful, wonder-working, comforting God, we are so grateful that you took the time to stop by and hear what's on our little hearts, oh God. That with everything going on in the world, that you still want to hear our petitions and our voices. Everything that has happened in our lives to this point and all the wrongs we've done and all the mistakes that we're trying to clear up, that you still say, my child, what's on your heart? What's on your mind? We say thank you for being that kind of God. The kind of God who has answered prayer before. So we are not being boastful or bold when we ask you for these things in prayer. We're only doing it because you've done it before, oh God. We're only asking because we've seen what you have done. We're only asking because we know that you are a wonder-working God. We're only asking because you told us to ask you in your Son's name, and that everything that we ask would be made so. In your will, oh God, not ours. God, we've asked for people to lift up their prayers. They may be writing things in the chat right now. They may be writing things on Facebook right now. And they may be putting things in the prayer for YouTube later on, oh God. But whatever it is, see the prayers and hear our voices, oh God. Hear our cry. We We've already lifted up and named names, oh God, but there are so many more that are in the depths of our heart that we cannot name. But we ask, oh God, that you would just, in your tender mercy, look into our hearts. And every person that has touched our lives, whose lives we touch, we ask that you lay your hand on them and bring them their new beginnings in faith, oh God. We ask that you would bring them through whatever trials and tribulations they're going on, that they're going through, so that they say, my God is bringing me through this, and I am getting through, I'm going to make it through. Let them have the boldness to claim it, and the strength, oh God, to keep on keeping on. That's what we need, oh God, is the strength. We can claim your power and your glory, but in our human weakness, we falter, oh God. We just want to be strong enough to stand up and do and claim our due from you, oh God. And then, oh God, we do know that we have been talking about immigrants today and folks that have housing insecurity and food insecurity, oh God. We have a different understanding of what it's like to travel because you're being persecuted at home, where you have to leave your community and leave your family and leave those who love you just to travel to a place that may be safe for you and your children and those that you love, oh God. We ask that you would bless those people who find themselves in that situation, in a strange land, trying to sing a new song, oh God. Help them find the communities that will love them and hold them, that will guide them through what it takes to make a new beginning in faith, oh God. Help us, oh God, to not get caught up in the political this or that of, are you going to feed the homeless or are you going to feed the immigrants? We need to feed all God's children. Please don't let us start to get into this political bickering about whose trauma is more important, because we know that you care for all of your children equally, God. May we figure out how to model and do what you are calling for us to do, that may we love, may we care, may we make a difference in somebody's life the way that you have made a difference in our lives, oh God. You have touched us and blessed us. You've given us families. You've given us people that have loved us. You've given us, some of us, people to go home to. And even if we have no one to go home to, we have a home to go to here in this room today. And even if we don't have that, God, we have our bodies. We have some modicum of strength and sanity. But we do know, oh God, that we are yours. And that we are your precious, precious children. And that nobody can take that away from us. They can take away our food. They can take away our apartment. But they can't take away the holiness that you see in us, oh God. So let us stand forth and stand strong in that holiness, no matter what the struggle is, no matter how people look at us, no matter what it is that we're going through, no matter if we're walking out of a jail cell tomorrow, no matter if we're in there today, we know that we are yours, oh God, and that we matter because you have claimed us. Our lives matter, oh God. May that resonate all throughout, oh God, to those who are feeling less than, to know that they matter and we claim them as yours. And that's why we pray for the stranger, for the people we do not know. That's why we pray for our enemies, oh God, to have them be able to see somehow, some way, your plan for them is to not be those who are thwarting the success and the benefit of your good graces to so many people in this world. God, we know that we are praying for a lot. We only do so because we know you can. God, no matter what, we want to thank you We want to never leave a prayer, oh God, without thanking you for what it is that you had done. But more importantly, oh God, more importantly, oh God, we want to thank you for what we know that you will do. Oh God, we thank you and cannot wait to see what this new beginning is that you have for each of us as we go through our lives from this day forward. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
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 Well, we got some plates up here, and if you would like to give your offering, our young ladies are not here today, who are boldly asking for people for money when they do their offering, but you all can feel free to stretch your legs and get up and put money in the offering plate. This is a wonderful opportunity that we keep in our service to let you get up and stretch your legs, and when we're all back in the sanctuary, we may do that again. We may have people come down to give their offering as much as they can to stretch their legs. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, yes, you brought me.
Yes, you brought me in the mighty. I'm my own.
You've been my mother. You've been my father. You've been my sister. Christmas tree gifts, but communion gifts. And I'm going to ask if Deacon Ray will come and help me to reveal these gifts today. Amen. Go in. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
The gifts of Christ are revealed.
Amen.
And amen. And I'm going to take this up and pass it on to you. Amen. Amen. We have revealed the gifts of Christ for the people of God. Amen and amen. And it's looking 95. Fresh communion cups. Amen. At this table, we celebrate of these simple gifts. Bread. Fruit of the vine. At this feast table, Christ welcomes all. No matter who you are or where you are in your journey, you are invited to rest a while. Just a while. And enjoy the hospitality of Jesus. We partake today in anticipation of the greater feast to come when we all get together. Anthony, you'll get to see your mom again at that feast table. You too, Harry. We'll all get to see, you'll get to see your husband at the feast table. I'll get to see my dad. You'll get to see your mom. You'll get to see your mom, dad, and grandma. Stephen, you'll get to see people that matter to you. And we'll all be around a table like this, laughing and smiling. So let us now move forward with our sacrament of the Lord's Supper. Stephen, you can share the screen because we have some responsive things that we're going to say in this prayer of Thanksgiving in our communion. I'll tell you when to stop sharing. Ruling out our prayer bracket, if you will.
Yes, yes, in our Thanksgiving for this feast together, we have our great prayer, God be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts unto the Lord.
We lift up our hearts unto the Lord.
Let us give God our thanks and praise.
It is right to give God our thanks and praise.
God was before all and embraced the cosmos in all its dark wonder. Into this, God brought light and darkness as brother and sister of equal merit. God spun the world into being and separating water and land. Trees and mountains sprang up and animals began to roam the face of the earth. God smiled and bent down to scoop up the clay of the earth, the Adamine Hebrew, to fashion a creature in God's own image and breathed the breath of life into that creature. For this creature, God created a helper. In their eagerness to be like God, they ate of the tree of knowledge, the only thing forbidden to them, and they were cast out of the garden. Since that moment, we have been seeking salvation and redemption as sin tries to overpower us while we run this race. But God has promised grace and mercy, and we will run on to see what the ends are going to be. We say together, holy, holy.
God, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
That grace and mercy came to us in Jesus. The Son of God came to live amongst us in flesh and blood. He told of God's power to save, showed God's power to heal, proved God's love for us. Christ was bold enough to die on the cross for the world to see. And in the darkness of the tomb, he buried the burden of sin and defeat and walked out victorious. Now that's the reason why we sing, the reason why we praise, the reason why we know that everything is going to be all right. Christ has died.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
You can stop sharing the screen. You know, we ask the Holy Spirit to come and bless you by saying, Holy Spirit, come. In your wisdom and power, we ask that you bless these gifts of bread and fruit of the vine. We ask that you do the same for those who are partaking at home or wherever they are while they join us today. Bless their bread and their fruit of the vine. Make them holy, holy, worthy of sharing around this table of Christ. And let us say the Lord's Prayer as we were taught, because it is a revolutionary way to claim that there is enough food for all, that there will be enough grace for all, and that there will be enough forgiveness of our debts for all. Let us say the Lord's Prayer by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our debts as we forgive others, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, forever and ever. Amen.
There was that night when Jesus sat up the table for Passover as the rabbi and as the teacher for all of those who were following him. Yes, the 12 were around the table, but there were a host of other people in that upper room celebrating Passover on that night. But this was the night on which Jesus was betrayed. And in the darkness of that upper room, Jesus gathered people to remember what it was like to recall how God brings you through by telling the story of Passover. He told all this, and that an unnamed woman will be remembered because she anoints his head with precious oils, one of the same oils that the three wise men gave him to commemorate the fact that he would die. Like so many other women, she tended Jesus in his last moments while the men ran away. In that dark room, he looked up at the faces of his followers in the flickering candlelight, and he took the bread and he lifted it up and he blessed it and gave thanks to God, most likely saying something like, Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu Ruach HaOlam, Asher Kidshanu B'Mitzvah. He broke it, and Jesus gave it to all who were gathered, and he said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Unless they think that was it, as they passed around the bread to eat, they'd done all of the blessings for Passover, but Jesus poured another cup of wine. And he took that cup, and he gave thanks for it, saying to God, Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Ruach HaOlam Oreh Pri Hagafen. He said, this is the cup of the new covenant sealed in my blood. So drink. And whenever you drink this in this setting, do this to remember me. I want all people to know that I am their ancestor. Remember me. Every time you eat this bread, and every time you drink this cup, you do show forth the Lord's death and his resurrection. And him who's coming again. And again, so do this in remembrance of him. Let us pray.
Oh,
come to you now, O God, our provider, and thanksgiving for this meal. It may not be the meal that we're planning for Sunday dinner, or the meal we remember from Christmas dinner, but it feeds us like no other, and we give you thanks for it. We give you thanks for this meal that has given us a new beginning, and we ask that you would let it move within us and stir up our faith, so that we may be the children that you send out into the world to go and be a Christian, to be Christ-like, to be loving, and to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Yes, the Holy Ghost fire, so that the world will know whose we are because of this meal and the commitment that we made. Remember you, your mission and your ministry in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
All right, we had a couple of printing issues today, but you're not going to have all of the lyrics of this last song, but you may know some of them. We're going to go 1 through 3, and then we're going to go up to 12 and come back. Children, go where I send you. We're not going to go 1 by 1, but we are going to go 1 through 3 and then 12 all the way back. You'll see. However you are called, go in your new beginning and hold on to that faith, yeah, knowing that it's going to bring you through whatever struggle, yeah, and whatever pothole is in the road that God is taking you down, yeah, that your faith is going to carry you through, because God always makes a way somehow. Yeah. So hold on to your faith. And amen really does mean may it be so. Hold on to your faith and your new beginning. May it be so. Sing with me at home and here.
Let the church say amen.
So let the church, let it say amen. Let all the people of God, this whole church, say amen. 'Cause God has spoken. So let the church say.
Mm-hmm.